Okay, let's bring out author John Green. Cara Delevingne. Matt Wolff. Halston Sage and director Jake Schreier.
Hey, everybody.
Hello.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
How's it going?
Hey.
It's good to see you. Wow. I haven't seen you in a while. We didn't really get to see.
Hi. Yes. Hi. Good to see you. Hi. Okay, good. All right, John, we're going to start with you.
Hi, Sara.
Hi. What was the most important thing for you when it comes to bringing Paper Towns from the book to the screen version? What was most important to keep from the book?
I'm not like a plot-driven writer or a plot-driven person, I guess. Like, so the most important thing to me was to keep the ideas, especially the idea that's at the center of the book, that it's incredibly difficult to imagine what it's like to be someone else. Like, it's incredibly difficult to sort of escape the prison of your consciousness and really empathize with other people, but that, like, it's also the central job of being a person. And I thought that Jake and Weber and Neustadter, who wrote such a brilliant script, did a great job of that. And then, the other thing is that, like, a movie is really ultimately made from its performances. And so I just had to cross my fingers and hope that the cast was good. And it turned out that instead of being good, they were great. And that's why the movie's great.
Aww.
I think.
Thanks, John.
Not so much Nat, but everyone else.
And Jake, as the director, what about for you? What was some of the favorite parts of the book that you wanted to make sure got on screen?
I also, more than anything, like, I love the theme of the book, that someone could write a story that was both about the tropes of a lot of high school books and then subverting all those tropes in the end, and that you could have an adventure that was super fun and a mystery that ultimately the twist was a character twist, and it was about the way that we look at women and put them up on pedestals that they can't sustain, and that you could do that in, like, a fun, engaging movie. I thought that was an incredible thing that John blended in the book, and if there was a way to do that in a movie, that was super exciting.
Yeah. And
The gas station scene.
Also the gas station scene. More than anything, really that. I just said the other thing that, like, sounds smart at the...
Yeah,
at
the but thing. You just really... The pee joke in the gas, in the car.
Lots of pee jokes. Mostly the pee jokes. Sorry, I'm doing this all wrong.
Well, so much about Paper Towns is sort of the idea that you have preconceived ideas about people before you meet them. So I'm curious, what surprised all of you guys about each other when you got to meet each other on set?
Sorry, I wasn't listening. What? No, I'm joking. You go.
I guess I realized, I was somehow the only human being on Earth that didn't know who Cara was. And she came into the chemistry read, and she just blew me away. Blew me away what a great actress she was. And then later on, I figured out that she was also this, huge star. But really, I hope everybody else can go into the movie without the preconceived notions of Cara and just see her as, a really good actress. And then, with a great actress like Halston, it was one of those things where I got to see a tape and I got to read with all the people. And I didn't pick anybody in the movie. That was Jake in the studio. But everybody who I like the best is in the movie. So, boom. I got good taste.
Boom. It was one of the most amazing experiences, which I don't think I'll ever do anything like this again. I really felt like I met some of the most amazing people I've ever met in my life. And everyone is so talented, but yeah, also some of the nicest people. And I really, hope that we can do a Paper Towns too, John.
John, yeah. Write it. Come on, John.
Woo, John.
Yeah.
So no, that was nice.
I'm on it. No, can we just have the same cast but in a different story?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, it takes place in Paris.
Like The Outsiders and Rumblefish.
Paper Towns in Paris.
The North Pole? Like,
no,
Eskimos.
How about Paris? The North Pole's all right, but how about Paris? Or, like...
Space.
What about...
Nope. Nope. That's... First off, there's no way we can afford the budget for space. Sorry, Halston. What were your preconceived notions about us?
I was, like Cara was saying, like, I went to an all-girls high school, and I had always had, like, this dream of what I wanted my high school experience to be like. And, you're a little girl, and you dream about going to prom and walking away with these, friends for life. And that's just how I felt about everyone on set. And I also learned that they're all crazy.
Not as crazy as you.
I'm kidding.
Yeah, I kind of had the same experience that... Q has or that like everyone has in the story, which is that like I went into it and I was like, oh, like I know about Cara because I follow her on Instagram, and like so I get Cara, and I know Nat because I've it's a little distracting you know, like we worked together on The Fault in Our Stars. And then when I met Halston, I was like, oh, and I know like bubbly blonde California girls, like I know what they're like. But like everybody was of course like far more complex than I imagined. And like Cara sort of deconstructed all of my ideas about her within minutes and turns out to be this incredibly sensitive, kind and generous person. Halston, you know, is smiley and is blonde and is from California, but is also super dorky and really intelligent and incredibly thoughtful and very talented. And Nat is, you know, he's got a great look, you know, like he looks like a movie star. So that's carried him a long way.
Okay, John.
I love Nat.
This is going really well for you, Nat. This is what? Really. This
Do you
is
want
great
me to move over? Yeah. Should I get out the way?
So basically, they're just all trying to burn me. They're all trying to diss me. But what we all learn is that we all love each other, and we're all here because we love John's book. We want to do it justice, you know. And we know you guys love it. So we wanted to make a movie that honored the feelings and the themes that you know it presented.
You did a great job, man.
Do you guys want to see a clip from the movie, maybe?
No.
Oh, okay. I'm going to try to do this with my Apple Watch.
What? Do I get an Apple Watch? Hold on.
Hold on. I'm going to try to make this happen.
So, Jake, do you want to set up a little bit what we just saw?
Q's been living his life exactly, like staying in his lane. He loves the girl from across the street, and he thinks he has no shot. He's going to go off to college. Everything's going to be fine. And then one night, she comes to his window and leads him on the most amazing night ever of revenge and excitement. And we just watched it. So that's what you, so that's what happened.
Was it okay? Come on, guys.
Bill.
Cara, was there something about the character of Margot particularly that interested you when you wanted to play her?
Not really. I kind of, yeah, there was so much. I think when I first read the book, it was, I needed to know Margot. I wanted to be friends with her. I wanted to be on that adventure. But I wanted to kind of figure her out more, and I think that was what drew me to her the most. And kind of figuring out that for myself as well, you know, making up her deepest secrets and her inner thoughts and stuff was really fun for me. And kind of going on the same journey as everyone else of like discovery with her was really cool.
Do you feel like you figured her out?
No, I'm still figuring her out. But I aspire to be Margot, you know. There are some, apart from the parts where she is not great. But, you know, that's part, you know, her fearlessness and just bravery and living in the moment and that kind of, you know, I think all of us can aspire to parts of Margot, apart from the bit where she leads him on. That's not nice. Don't do that.
Yeah, I mean, I felt like I learned a lot about the characters through making the movie, which was really cool to me because, you know, this is a book that came out 7 years ago and it was interesting to revisit it. And, you know, Cara brought things to Margot that helped me to understand Margot in a way that I didn't really when I was writing the book. And, you know, Halston and Austin and Justice and Jazz all brought things to their characters that really gave it lots of like nuance and complexity and made those relationships feel so real to me, even when I was on set, but then like especially when I was watching the movie. And then the only character that like I thought I knew all the way was Q, because I see the world out of his eyes when I'm writing, and I was really worried about that. Like I was really worried about like when Nat doesn't sound like the Q of my imagination, am I gonna be like Nat? He says it like this. He says it like this. But what actually happened is that, like, from the moment I got to the set, Nat just became Q for me, and everything sounded the way it sounded in my head, and that was just magical to feel like, wow, he understands this kid like completely, and that meant so much to me. That was the coolest part of the whole movie process for me.
Thanks, John.
We have some
He's
questions.
So nice.
It's true. I wouldn't be here if I didn't like you guys. I'd be home with my cool kids.
You John. Like us better than your kids?
crap. I already see the headline.
Do you want to pick one of these questions?
Oh, sure.
We
We've got some social questions for the cast on our iPad. It's amazing how many like Apple products are here. I don't know why. What was your favorite scene to shoot in the movie? This comes from at Edward is the man. I don't know if Edward is also the person tweeting it or if it's a different Edward, but...
That's actually my Twitter, so...
Oh, who's the Edward that you like so much? Oh, you are Edward? Oh.
Multifaceted, John.
Yeah, you can take, as Whitman put it, you contain multitudes. What was your favorite scene to film?
I don't know. The whole pranking night was really one of the most amazing things, especially to live in your mind. I was like, who... Did you do a lot of pranks? How creative are you with pranks? If I ever need to do one, I know who I'm coming to.
Yeah.
Because
you should come to my wife, because she plotted most of that stuff out for me.
Ah. No,
you know
I
Sarah. She's
Sarah.
Pretty, she's hard. Uh-huh. Yeah, she doesn't mess around.
And no, never play pool with her, because she'll whoop you.
Yeah.
As we all know.
Yeah. Jake, Cara, and I all got schooled at pool by Sarah.
Yeah, she pool sharked us.
Schooled at pool.
Yeah, she lost the first game on purpose. Like a real pool shark
Didn't
would.
Didn't we bet money on that?
Yeah, and then when we started betting money, she started killing it. Yeah. Nat?
Did I play pool with...
I would say
my favorite scene would probably... I have two. One of them was when... One of the first scene that I shot with Cara was when we're in the street and we're saying goodbye to each other for the night, and she tells me that my comfort zone is really small, and there was something magical about it, and I just knew, oh, this is going to be good.
That was Quentin the first scene we shot.
Yeah, first one we shot.
So nice.
And and then my other favorite was like one of the last scenes I shot when I came to prom. And there's no lines in it or anything, but I was saying goodbye to the characters. You know, Quentin is saying goodbye to his friends, basically, but he's coming to prom. And at the same time, I was kind of saying goodbye to those actors, you know, because we had spent this amazing 2 months together, and so it felt completely real. And, you know, constantly you're always searching for things that blur the line between the movie and reality, and then it always gets kind of mixed up. And that was one of those really great moments where it felt completely real, you know, saying goodbye to Justice and Austin and Halston and Jazz, and then, you know, and also Cara.
Halston?
I also had two favorite scenes. I loved bathtub scene.
So good in the movie. I love that scene.
Thanks, John. No, I think when I was reading the book and the script, it was the first time I actually was like, okay, I'm going to have to kill someone to be in this movie. Like, I just related to Lacey so much. And some of the words that John had actually written were thoughts I'd had growing up and still have today. So, and of course, I had... that scene with Nat, so that was really amazing to work with him. But also the gas station scene was really fun. It was like really fast. Like, you know, the gas station scene happened so quickly, and we actually filmed it. It was like we were just running all day.
One of my favorite line in the movie is probably when Halston says, "1 minute!" When she screams out in the gas station, because Halston has so many amazing talents, but voice control is not one of them.
She's very loud.
Volume level is not one of them.
So when you see that in the movie, it's an inside joke. You'll know about it. You'll know why
she just screams out 1 minute. We had her.
But that's something I love about Halston. Like, Halston is so, like, when I say that Halston is like dorky or nerdy, what I mean is that like she's like completely unironically enthusiastic, and like she gets genuinely excited about stuff, and that's super refreshing. Like, I see that as a huge character asset. So it's true that you can't control whether you are whispering or yelling, but it's because you're an enthusiast.
That's why. Thanks, John.
My favorite scene. So there's a scene in the movie where Q and Margo are dancing and there's a song playing. And when I was a nerdy kid about the age that Q would have been, I listened to crappy light rock radio. And one of my favorite songs was Lady in Red by Christa Berg, which none of you know. Maybe some of you know it. You're about to know it big
time. It's going to have a great second life now.
Because they're dancing to Muzak. And I was like, do I get to pick the Muzak for the scene? And they were like, yeah, do you have any ideas? And I was like, I have one very specific idea.
And we listened to it on set.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's now Nat's new favorite song, I hope. Is that, Lady in Red.
Lady in Red. I think you're going to have to bleep that for copyright, or else Christa Berg is going to get a check.
John, do you have a favorite scene? Can you pick?
I mean, it's really hard for me to pick because
I really like the movie, and I feel so grateful to everybody who made it. I feel like I won the lottery. The bathtub scene is really one of my favorite scenes in the movie. Everything that happens that night on the road trip, there's a conversation. They're going on a big road trip, and then they, for reasons that involve a cow, end up on the side of the road for a little while chatting. And that whole night was really special for me. And I think the conversation with the boys is pretty awesome. And Halston and Austin have a really great scene there. And Jazz and I only call Radar Justice. I always mix up real names. Sorry. Jazz and Justice have a great scene in there. And that's like that whole night feels really special to me.
We just call you Author.
I know I've got to stop calling you guys by your character names. It's super rude.
We're going to show another clip. Do you want to explain it ahead of this time beforehand? Let's do it that way.
Before the clip. So this is later on in the night. They've already played a few pranks. Things are escalating, and then they get to one Chuck Parsons house.
And I am genuinely going to try to do this with my Apple Watch
again. I feel like I saw the lights dim before you touched anything on that watch, John. I don't know if I believe
you. John isn't doing this on his watch.
I am doing it. Look, watch. Watch. You can't do it. You don't have the power. No. You're messing it up. Car. It's in my ear.
Car broke the clip.
Always wet willies. Always. That makes it worse. Now it's on music. I got it.
Didn't do anything.
I did do it.
He knew every word. That was amazing.
I've only watched it 90 times.
So,
like I said, one thing about that clip. So that my first meeting with the producers when I was trying to get this movie very badly, one of the only ideas I had for them was like, at some point, Margo should do like a Dukes of Hazzard power slide over a minivan, for which you definitely cannot do it. And Cara did such an amazing job of that in the actual movie. It made me very happy.
I thought that was my idea. Come on.
Well, that's convenient.
Okay.
That was actually one of my favorite scenes of the movie. So they're
pretty
good.
Great.
It's pretty good.
Chuck Parsons, yeah.
I like revenge. Do you want to pick another one of these, John?
Oh, sure. How about this question from Infinitely Brave? Another bold
that's
Twitter
me.
Handle.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's another Cara pseudonym. One thing you couldn't leave behind when going on a road trip.
Paper Towns.
It's true.
John Green. You
the
guys.
DVD. Oh, no, the book. That's much better. Great point. The book, Paper Towns.
You can probably leave me behind because I'm the worst driver that ever existed.
But you're good. You're good entertainment.
I'm still afraid from every time we got in a car with Nat. Yeah.
Nat got his driver's license, I think, 2 days before we started shooting and had to do all the driving.
I didn't even have the physical license. I just had a receipt.
He nearly ran over an AD. That was fun.
Let me tell you, the state of New York is great in so many ways, but there is something fundamentally wrong with the way that it distributes driver's licenses to people because there is
NYC. NYC.
There is no way on earth that Nat Wolff should have been issued a license. The one thing that I would take Nat, because even though I would have to do all the driving, I would have amazing company.
Thanks, John.
I'm only allowed to take
one. Yeah, me and Halston. We'll go on our own road trip,
Cara.
Babe. Yeah, thanks.
I think I'd rather go with them, John.
Exactly.
All right, Jake and I are going on a road trip.
Yay.
Jake? I'll take you, John.
Thanks, buddy.
So you guys obviously all got along really well. You're in North Carolina filming, right? Did any of you take any souvenirs from the set home with you?
We all got a Black Santa. That was fun.
I took Austin Abrams.
I'm kidding. I took my shoes home with me. I don't know if I was allowed, but I did. You know,
Cara, we're
nice
gonna need those back. We've been wondering where the shoes were, and thanks for reporting it.
Okay.
I took a lot of stuff. I took Ben's beer sword. I took the J in the Jefferson Park High School sign. I took Q's copy of the fourth Harry Potter book.
Did you take the Mountain Goats poster?
I took the Mountain Goats poster, and I also took the Woody Guthrie poster. I, on the last day after they wrapped, I basically like
robbed.
I basically went to the set and took everything that wasn't nailed down.
Actually, one of the nicest things that John did is got all of us a gift of the actual original Esso map, one of the first maps to actually have Aglo printed on it.
I wrote you a note. I wrote you a note. And you
All of us except for Cara, because she got the shoes, and so no, she
Cara,
didn't get the map.
Cara now remembers. It just took her a second. But yeah, so I got everybody maps with the actual Aglo on them from the 30s and 40s.
Thank you, John.
Yeah, thank you.
Nat clearly has lost his, but that's all right.
Oh, no. It's right under, it's in my drawer.
Where the unicorns are, under my bed.
Well, how helpful is it to have the author on set every day when you guys are working on the movie? Did you guys get to come and talk to him about your characters? And
he was actually there as a distraction to try and make our lives harder. He was there for me as a hand warmer target. Which was fun.
Yeah, Cara kept throwing... It was very cold in North Carolina, and Cara would throw the hand warmers at me. And she has... I mean, among Cara's many talents is that she has just astonishing arm strength. I mean, she could be a Major League Baseball pitcher if she wanted to be, but she also has astonishing accuracy. So I would just be, like, sitting next to the monitors with Jake, the director, and I would see Jake take, like, a half a step back. And I would be like, well, that's an interesting thing. I wonder why Jake... Ow!
And they're not soft either.
No, it wasn't fun. Yeah. I did not enjoy it.
It was great for me, though. So, yay, thanks.
Glad I could help.
It was wonderful.
I mean, actually, when it came down, you know, before we started shooting, I had already been friends with John from The Fault in Our Stars. And... we had talked a couple times about the movie, but really just having him there and his positivity that he brings everywhere he goes and his insight, obviously, into his own book and, you know, him making sure that we stayed true to the themes and the feelings of the book, but maybe not like every single little detail. He was kind of loose about that. Was vital, totally vital.
I really felt like you were a piece of the puzzle, and you know, if we hadn't had you, it wouldn't have been complete. Like that first night, and we went to get pizza together. Yeah. I really felt like that was the first night we felt like family. It was magical.
It just felt like having him there. It meant like we couldn't really do anything wrong. Like in the sense that he as long as he said it was okay, like hopefully we'd be making everyone who was such a big fan of the book happy. And he's also really funny, so he'd make us laugh. And as it was nice. Yeah,
like what did you do, Jake?
What did I do? I was just there. The DJA mandates that a director has to be on set. So I just stood there and they gave me a check and it was great. Like, it was awesome. No, I mean, the really great thing about John is exactly what he said, is that he's so, A, excited just to be making a movie and really wants the movie to stand on its own as a piece of art. And is, like, if we had to talk about a change to a scene or something for a character or a thing that was going to be different, he was excited to explore that. Because it is, in a way, like, a second chance at these characters and to work with great actors that can explore them. And so it's just having a great creative partner there to work on it with.
I did almost nothing. They're all being very nice. But Jake worked like 22 hours a day for the last year. So that was nice. Thanks, Jake.
Thanks, Jake. He did. Ooh. He did.
Yeah, Jake is the hardest working director that I've ever worked with. He's he works his ass off, and
he gave
it
up
shows
his soul for this film, so we love him for that.
By the end of the shoot, he just became paler and smaller and thinner. And I remember
he looks so much better now.
He looks like a person now, but he looked like a zombie at the end of it. And one night, I remember he texted me, and he came over to my apartment, and he just knocked on the door, and he was like, "Can I have a frozen pizza? I think I forgot to eat today." And I was like, you've come to the right place.
Please, sir, do you
have
anything to eat?
Because I've got 100 frozen pizzas.
Also, he wore a suit to set every day, which was super
so dashing.
Yeah. Suit and tie.
It was very dashing. It was very like old fashioned.
That's just cool. So I don't get mistaken for a PA. You know, I'm just trying to.
He also has an exceptionally strong shoe game while we're complimenting Jake. I mean, every
all
day...
Right, enough
would,
of this.
We'd be like hiking,
question on the thing. Can
we'd
I
be like hiking through the mud in North Carolina, and he'd be wearing these like amazing designer shoes.
We're going to stop embarrassing Jake and let him set up the last clip. And then we'll get to you guys and questions in a second after that.
All right. So the last clip is the... we talked a little bit about it. We talked about the gas station scene. And this, when I read the book, this was really one of the first scenes where it was like, I have to film this scene. I mean, it's so visual in the way John writes about it. And it also was just, it really was one of the most fun days on set because everyone was just running all over the place and throwing things, and it was just a...
Nat has a really cool spin.
Yeah, I got to like live out my fantasy of destroying a grocery store. You know, that thing that goes through my mind every single time I go inside a grocery store? And I'm like, what if I could just throw everything off the shelf on the ground and stomp on it? And then Jake said, do that. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was great.
You are so sweet.
Okay.
Oh, wait.
Here we go.
Also, there's a little extra secret in that scene in the movie when you go see it, but we can't say what it is. You shush.
Okay.
All right, we're going to take another question from social media here from Books You Know. Best high school memory, John.
I've got a lot of good and terrible high school memories. Maybe the best was the last night of high school I went to. We didn't have a prom, but we had a thing called senior banquet. And I went with a really good friend, not a girlfriend, named Amanda, who now lives in New York, by the way. And it was just an amazing night with people I'd come to really care about and the kind of the formative friendships of my youth. Just had great conversations, and it was just a really special night.
Teenage memory, Cara?
Probably leaving. No, I'm joking. I loved school so much. It was probably, this is funny. Well, I used to play a lot of pranks at school. I wasn't distracting. I was just doing it to make people laugh. I think people learn more when they're having a good time. So I used to play a lot of pranks. These are a couple of tips if you want some good ones. I used to... you know, come up with like little lines to say while we were in class, and when I'd say them, everyone would freeze, and we just wait for as long as possible until the teacher got really confused. And then like every time the teacher turned around, we would move our desks and chairs closer to the teacher every time. So by the end, we were all like stuck at the front. Just a couple little things like that. And also get as many song title names as you could into your answers for the questions. You're like, you know, well, I'm gonna, anyway. Ha! Oh, your turn. Okay.
Well, I was technically a teenager when we made the movie, so I can say that making this movie was one of the best experiences that I had as a teenager. And now I leave it up to Halston to come up with something creative.
Go, Halston, go.
No, well, I said, Paper Towns was the high school experience I always wanted. So I guess my favorite high school memory was maybe when I graduated. Cool speaker. We had Sarah Silverman, and she spoke, and she gave some really good advice. And
your high school graduation speaker was Sarah Silverman.
Yeah, it was amazing.
Local business leader.
You were booked, John. John, you were booked. No, she gave really good advice. She said to eulogize the living, which is really dark, but I don't know. It just really resonated with me. And
was it favorite or most embarrassing? Was it
most embarrassing?
Most embarrassing. All I remember is
you said most embarrassing?
No, she didn't, but I want to hear Jake's embarrassing story.
Me too.
Jake, most embarrassing.
This isn't going to quite live up to your expectations. All of high school was the most embarrassing for me, but... I went to high school in Berkeley, which is like a weird place on the other side of the country where weird things happen. So our biology teacher taught us how to make moonshine with apple juice and fermented yeast. And then he was like, none of you make this at home. Wink, wink. And so everyone made moonshine in their houses, in their basements. And then the first time me and my friend Aaron went to take it to a party, he spilled it in my mom's trunk. And so for the rest of high school, my mom's Camry smelled like fermented apple juice. So there you go.
There's a little underage drinking story for you.
Yeah, but it's so nerdy that I don't know that it really counts.
We didn't drink it because he spilled it. So.
Oh, got it. Sure. So spilled your drink.
Attempt at underage drinking.
Spill your
drink. It's a lesser crime.
Do you want to ask everybody the last one here from at fan community?
I'll do it.
Yeah, sure. You do it, Cara. From at fan community.
I can't read. Oh, wait. Oh, yeah. Can you describe the cast of Paper Towns in one word? Brilliant. Am I right? No?
Cara stole my word.
Fun?
I would actually say kind, because I think like ultimately what
my memory of it and like what stands out for me is this extraordinary generosity they showed to the story and like how much of themselves they gave to those characters and how hard they worked. And also how good they were and are to each other. So
it's
I
like
would say
80
kind.
Words. That's so
I
many
said,
words.
He's a writer. My word is kind.
He's a writer.
I would say friends.
Oh, I like that. Dedicated. I think everyone loved this story so much, and they just put all of their heart into it, and hopefully it shows in the movie.
Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
All right. Well, John took all the nice, sweet stuff that I also believe in. They're wonderful people. I'll just go with young.
You are just lovely
compared to us.
That's fair. I think, do you guys have some questions out here in the audience?
How's it going, everybody? My question is actually for John. I want to know, you know, getting a second crack at these things, you know, when it comes to maybe an ending or a scene or something like that, is that added pressure or do you look at it as sort of a blessing that, you know, maybe something that the book came out and you can never really sort of re-release a book or do a second edition of a book, but a movie is a second go at things. So how do you approach that? Thanks.
That's a great question. I mean, there are a lot of blessings in being able to kind of go back to the story. I think Scott and Mike, who wrote the screenplay, did a lot of things that looking back, I wish I'd done in the book. That's also true in The Fault in Our Stars, especially having Angela on the road trip and really drawing out those relationships and the arcs of the characters who aren't, you know, the two central characters. And I really enjoyed watching that happen, but I tragically can't take credit for any of it. Also, I mean, the kids made the movie better. There's one thing, I don't want to spoil it, but like there's one moment where they all sing a song together. That's one of my favorite things that in the whole movie. And they just, Halston or possibly Justice, they argue about it, like just came up with it, you know, while we were on set.
It was me, John.
It was Halston. I remember it as being Halston, but I love Justice, and I don't want to hurt his feelings.
It was Halston.
I feel like I have to defend Justice, because he's my friend.
No, I'm sitting right next to you.
It is way more like Justice to lie. But, but at the same time, I have a vague memory of Justice coming up. Cara? I have a vague memory of Justice coming up with it. So I just have to put
anyway,
that out
yeah,
there.
Anyway, yeah, so like one of the fun things about that collaboration, one of the fun things about that collaboration is that more things can happen, like more good things can come from it than can just come from me writing a novel.
Halston actually wrote Paper Towns, so anyway.
That was that was a really amazing thing about having a group of kids who are all between 18 and 22 as the cast, because there are a lot of references in the movie where, you know, you could just go to them and be like, what was relevant to you? Like, what was the movie you guys snuck into when you were younger? And then that goes right in the film and it's authentic and it comes from them. And that was great to be able to add.
I do want to say, though, that I quite like the book. And even though it was written a long time ago, like I don't have any desire to change it. You know, like I don't have a desire to go back and change it. And I think the book is the book and the movie is the movie. And I'm so glad that that is true, that the book isn't trying to be a movie and the movie doesn't try to be a book.
Hi, I'm a huge fan from Kuwait. I came all the way here to watch you guys. Me and my friends.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thanks for coming.
My friends and I at school, we have this thing called the Jara Crew. We made it a long time ago, about a year ago, I think, because we're really huge fans of you, John, and Cara. So I was wondering if I could get a shout out from you guys.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Them.
Jara.
Jara. We love Jara. The Jara Club.
Thank you.
You guys rule.
Well, first, I just wanted to say that The Fault in Our Stars changed my life because, like, my mom has a terminal diagnosis, and she was supposed to pass away a while ago. But she's still here today, thank God. And like enough of the sappy stuff. My question was, if Augustus and Hazel were best friends with Q and Margo, what kind of adventures would they go on?
Oh, that's a great question.
Cool. That's the cutest question.
First, about the sappy stuff, if I may for a moment, just say thank you and thanks for sharing that with me, but also thank you for finding stuff to connect to in that story, because that means more to me than anything. I mean, it's the greatest gift in my life, so thank you. I think that Gus and Hazel and Q and Margo could have a heck of a good road trip. In some ways, like Gus and Hazel were sort of denied a good road trip because their author lived across an ocean, so they couldn't drive.
But I think it would be fun. In the first draft of The Fault in Our Stars, I had Hazel and Van Houten go on a road trip to Mexico. It's turned out to be a very bad thing on many levels. My publisher and editor, Julie Strauss-Gable, who's here today, blessedly said the first 200 pages of this novel are quite promising, and the last 50 pages reads like really terrible John Green fan fiction. Like, you got to the end of the book, and you were like, there hasn't been a road trip. I guess I have to have one. But yeah, I don't know. Maybe they'd go on a grand adventure to the Grand Canyon together or something.
Disneyland.
Oh, Disneyland, yeah. That'd be easy, because Q and Margo are already in Orlando. So.
Hey, guys.
Hi.
Hi. Okay, so my question is for Cara specifically. I love you, and...
Love you too, babe. Thank you.
Like, your transition from being a model and going into the acting world, just in general, how did you do that transition, and how did you feel, Jake, with having... I mean, I know you guys love Cara, but how did you feel with having someone... Like, were you okay with that? Were you kind of, like, scared about that?
Wasn't too okay with it. It was really... No, wait. So, I just want to say... So, Cara, you're 22, right? So when I was 22, I think I worked as a data entry clerk at like my friend's mom's. Like, we have all done things before we do the thing we eventually are going to do. And like, they're all such a young cast. Cara's been in a bunch of movies before this, and Justice and Jazz hadn't been in a movie before. Like, no one at this level should be judged for what they did beforehand. It's only about the talent that you bring to it. And, you know, Cara didn't get this role because I also don't really use Instagram or know anything about fashion. The shoes thing is wrong. I didn't know who Cara was really before this either. She came into the room and she blew us away with her audition, and that's why she's in this movie, and for no other reason than that.
Yeah, I mean, Cara would be in the movie if she'd never been a model, because as long as she'd gotten an audition, because when she got the audition, it was very clear that she was the right person to play Margot, and that she understood in like seemingly impossible ways what it's like to be one of those people who everyone is paying attention to, but no one is actually listening to. And that's one of the key, that's the key thing about Margot, you know, Margot has to be pushing against that. And I could feel that in the audition so intensely. And also she made Nat, you know, like she made Nat better, and the way that they worked together was really intense and exciting. And yeah, I completely agree. Like, she's just I'm going to let you answer the question, but like from our perspective,
oh,
like,
that's a hard question for her to answer.
She's
and
just
I agree
a great
100%.
Actor. Yeah.
I don't know what to say. I feel like you guys said anything. I feel like as a cast, we all made each other better. And that's why I think all of us, worked so well together. I don't know, for me, I think we live in a world where we all love so many different things, and I think to put anyone in a box is the worst thing you can do nowadays. I feel like maybe I'll change what I do when I'm 80 years old. I feel like that's why we're so blessed and why we have such an amazing world where we can kind of branch out and do these things. You know, there are a lot of actresses who are amazing who were models before, but they just weren't really known models. And I think for me, if I was to ever get a part because of my following, I would rather not do it at all. You know, I want to be picked because I bring something to the role that maybe other people don't. And if not, then I'll just carry on modeling. It's not a bad job. I don't care.
And if she doesn't, yeah. And if you don't keep acting, we're all going to be really upset. You're too talented.
Thanks, pretty. Because Nat's going to be a supermodel very soon.
Yeah, I will be taking up
the
supermodel.
Yeah, that's the other thing. Nobody ever talks about
my supermodel career.
Dudes who are both actors and models, which are most movie stars, including like...
And girls.
Huh? Like,
and
I
girls.
Mean, like Ansel is a great actor who is in The Fault in Our Stars, but also does a ton of modeling. Nat
is
a brilliant DJ. Actor.
I don't do modeling.
Aren't you a supermodel? No.
Not to my knowledge, but maybe, is there anybody here
he
casting?
He also does music. Halston's an incredible horse rider and does many other things, philanthropy-wise. You know, we all have he does books. Did you know that?
I
know,
he
we all
does
have
books.
He does
I do
books.
Them.
Apparently, I'm very good at English, so that's good. Where? Oh, we got him.
Hi.
What happened to your arm?
Did you get that cast just so they would ask, just so you could ask a question?
Sign it?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll sign your cast.
I was wondering... What like behind the scenes, like what did you guys I was wondering like what your favorite moments were like behind the scenes and stuff.
They all went out to dinner a lot, and like sometimes they would let me come, and that's some of my favorite memories is just of like going to dinner with them. And then I guess my least favorite behind the scene memory is that is when they would break into my apartment at 3 o'clock in the morning and jump on my bed and scream until I woke up.
He has cookies next to his bed. It's amazing.
And then they would make fun of me because I eat cookies in bed because I was alone and lonely for 2 months and I ate cookies in bed and I'm not going to apologize for it. And they and Halston would be like, why are you eating cookies in bed? And I would be like, because...
Why are you not eating
the
cookies in bed?
But that's when I started to like John even more. I was like, okay, we're friends.
Finally.
Cara, I was wondering if you can sign my cast.
Yeah. Get here. Come to me, child.
Cool. What's your name? Carly. Carly with a K? Thank you so much. Some behind the scenes.
Thank you.
I guess one of my favorite behind the scenes memories was a lot for me. A lot of the work that I did to play Quentin was like almost going back in a time machine and like limiting myself and going back to a time when and listening to a lot of music that I listened to that was on the radio when I was a little younger. Like, do you guys remember the song "Human" by The Killers?
Aww.
So I hadn't heard that song in 5 years probably, but I started to listen to it again because it got me back to a place that I liked for the movie. But then it became like the song of the road trip, and it became the song of the movie. And we listened to it almost every single day. And then yesterday or 2 days ago, we saw each other. We did a press conference all together for the first time. It was the first time we were all together since the movie, like when everybody was together, even though we've all stayed super close. And we played that song, and we were all jumping up and down, and I got really teary-eyed. And it's like this song I don't even remember liking that much when I was younger.
That and Blank Space.
Yeah, and yeah. That and the little Tay-Tay.
And we should also say that, Nat, you are on the soundtrack of the movie, you and your brother Alex, right?
Yeah,
Nat's song in the soundtrack is so great. It's called Look Outside, and I love it so much.
So when we finished filming, I was really sad. you know, it was like coming out of a haze almost. Like it was this beautiful experience. Thanks, Cara. And I wrote this song on my grandparents' piano like 2 days after we finished, called "Look Outside," and I sent it to everybody. You know, totally inspired by the experience making it. And then about 4 months later, I found out Jake had put it at the end of the movie. So it's super extra special for me and for my brother. And I'm really thankful to Jake and for the studio and everybody for putting it in.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. Go see the movie July 21st, right?
Yeah.
4th. July 24th. Go see Paper Towns.
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you
it's
so
been
much
great to meet you. Take care.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you guys so much.